Usama Darrah, who will be the chair of this roundtable. But before to give the floor to him, I would like to ask all our speakers to sign our golden book, as it is the tradition in the Swiss Press Club, just a signature there. And I will give the floor to Usama. So please. And you will also present the speakers, yeah. Okay. So I think we can.
Okay. Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for attending. Thank you very much to the Swiss Club de Presse for hosting. And of course, thank you also to the Syrian Organisation for the Victims of War, which is the organization behind CSER, for putting together this very important event today. Ladies and gentlemen, the pictures on the wall that you see are part of a file of over 50,000 photos shot by a military photographer or a military policeman in Syria. And they were smuggled out several years ago. And the CSER photographs, they present the horrifying brutality and also the magnitude of systematic human rights abuses, violations committed by the Assad regime. This is a reality faced by tens of thousands of Syrians today and that are still detained in their country. I'd like to remind you at this point that these are not individuals that are committing these crimes or simply Syrian institutions. We are looking at a systematic and planned state policy. And there has been a UN commission of inquiry several months ago, just recently, that used the language of a policy of extermination to describe these events. So amidst the talks here in Geneva and the discussions over a political transition, these photographs are a very, very powerful reminder of not just the human suffering that Assad has inflicted on the Syrian people. But it's, I think, more important even to flesh out the importance of establishing justice for these victims and accountability. So I have the great pleasure to now introduce the excellent panel who will say a few words each before we open the floor to the discussions. I'd like to introduce Mr. Mazen Darwish, first of all. Mazen is the director of the Syrian Center for Media and Freedom of Expression. I met Mazen in Berlin just a few days ago. He's been working in this field for 20 years, one of the foremost on in terms of the databases, personally having been arrested by the regime 6 times, and most recently, 2012. He was just released in August of last year after a stint of 3.5 years in prison. I'd also like to introduce Ms. Hanada Al-Refai. She's a Syrian activist and a member of the Syrian Organization for the Victims of War, the organization behind the CSER file. Thank you very much for being here. She was arrested for her activism in Syria and detained by the infamous Air Force intelligence branch in Damascus. I have beside me Ms. Hind Kabawat. She is a member of the Higher Negotiations Committee, which is negotiating here in Geneva on behalf of the entire opposition movement, and serves there as the head of the legal branch. She's also the director of the Interfaith Peace Building at George Mason University. Beside me, I have Mr. Yahya, Professor Yahya Al-Aridhi, a member of the Syrian Organisation for the Victims of War, also with the Caesar file, and a member of the Syrian National Movement. Previous, he was the Dean of the Faculty of Media and Communication at the University of Damascus. And since defecting from the regime, Yahya has focused his efforts on supporting accountability and transitional justice. And finally, Mr. Gareth Bayley is the UK's special representative to Syria. The UK recently ran a public campaign highlighting the plight of political detainees in Syria and calls for their release as a confidence-building measure within the context of the discussions here. So the way we will organize this, sorry. Who? No, I introduced Hanada. Yeah. I thought we would just let each of the speakers have a brief statement of 5 to 7 minutes, and then after that, open the floor to the public. I'd like to begin with Mr. Professor Yahya Al-Aridhi. The floor is yours, sir.
Thank you.
Just press that.
Good evening, everybody. What you see around you, those pictures, is just a matter of 11,000 collection. And this is also part of a collection of 55,000. And those 55 were not numbers. They are the victims of a non-stop Holocaust in Syria. While we are talking now, definitely in the Syrian so-called grave of the alive, graves of the alive, we have people turning into something similar to these in the pictures. This is what is happening, and it is consistent policy. And there is this scream. That's why this scream is there, in order to stop this Holocaust, stop this tragedy. We have specific goals in this organization. The first goal is to tell you that these are human beings, not numbers, and they are not only Syrians. They are Jordanians, they are Palestinians, and they are also other people that one day were with the regime. As you might have seen, somebody with a picture on his belly of Bashar al-Assad, and that is somebody who must have been saying something against the policy set. And that's why he was tortured to death as such. The other one is we are looking at a system or a regime or a gang that cannot be rehabilitated as the attempts have been going on for some time on the part of powerful powers. And in the political process, this issue of victims of war or transitional justice or the human dimension has been somehow sidelined. And this is no good, because you cannot have a settlement, you cannot lessen tension, you cannot heal a very deep wound without having transitional justice. And this is a call for the international community. A quick idea about the source of these pictures, how they were smuggled out of Syria. There's somebody who is a former Syrian parliament member who helped Caesar and his 27-member family, who helped smuggle him out, and something is exposed about this tragedy. I don't want to take much time. I have so many things to say. We can talk about our tragedy till the end of life, maybe. But This is a very quick sample of our tragedy. It's a scream, and we want the world to hear it. Thank you.
I give the word to Mr. Mazen Darwish.
Thank you. I'm very fat. I'm very fat. I like food. When I arrested, I was 117 kilo. After 10 months in the Air Force branches, I'm very lucky that they transfer me to a civilian prison. At that time, I was 58 kilo. Unfortunately, my colleague, Ayham Ghazoul, he was not lucky, was arrested with me on the same day from my office. He's one of those people in these pictures. I am 28 years. He's a doctor, medicine. And now, while we are here talking, as Dr. Al-Aridhi said, there is some Syrian in this situation, in this condition, some of them perhaps now dying. This is not my first time as arrested. There is something change after 2011. Before 2011, there is torture always in Syria, but it's because of the information. They want to collect information from the prisoner. So while they finish the investigation, the torture stopped. I mean, since 2011, the torture for torture to destroy people, to kill their soul and their body as a result. I'm so sorry for my bad English, so perhaps I will be more comfortable to speak in Arabic, if you please. خرج الشباب السوري مع بداية 2011 للتظاهر يغنوا يرقصوا بالساحات والشوارع.
Syrian youth as of 2011 went out on the streets to demonstrate, to sing, and to love.
استخدم الاعتقال والتعذيب وسوء المعاملة لدفع الناس باتجاه العنف والاحتقان.
The method that was adopted to counter these demonstrations consisted of detention, mistreatment, ill-treatment, torture, all this to spread out violence and anger.
بال 2011 اعتقلت مرتين اللي كنا نسمعه دائما من هدول الشباب انا عندي استعداد موت وما ارجع على الاعتقال مره اخرى.
After 2011, I was detained twice, and I have always heard all youngsters, all young people saying after being detained that they would prefer to die rather than go back to those detention centers.
بالوقت اللي تمرست فيه كل أنواع التعذيب والضغط النفسي وسوء المعاملة بشكل ممنهج استهدف أيضا النشطاء المدنيين والفعاليات المجتمعية اللي كانت بتشكل صمامات أمان.
And actually all forms and kinds of torture have been adopted, have been used. In addition to psychological pressure, ill treatment, all this was done in a systematic way against civil society, civil activists, and civil figures, all of whom used to constitute a protection force.
بتسأل الناس كيف راح الثورة السورية باتجاه العنف والتطرف هذا واحد من الأسباب الرئيسية.
So for those who wonder why Syrian revolution has become a violent revolution, well, this is one of the reasons.
اليوم في حديث عن حلول سياسية وفي مفاوضات.
Today we are talking about political solution and negotiations.
للأسف كل قرارات الأمم المتحدة المتعلقة بسوريا تم سحب المحاسبة منها.
Unfortunately, all UN resolutions about Syria have no mention at all about accountability.
بدون عدالة لن يكون هناك سلام في سوريا.
Well, actually, without any justice, we won't have any peace in Syria.
والعدالة تقتضي المحاسبة.
And justice is about accountability.
لذلك لابد من مسار حقيقي للعدالة الانتقالية في سوريا.
Therefore, we need to have a true process, a real process of transitional justice in Syria.
لكي تكون هذه الحلول السياسية قابلة للحياة.
So as all political solutions can be applicable.
بدون عدالة أي حل سياسي سيكون قنبلة موقوتة.
Well, without justice, all political solutions would be like time bombs.
ستنفجر بأي لحظة وتعيد الصراع بشكل أقصى وأسوأ مرة أخرى إلى سوريا وإلى المنطقة بأكملها.
Those time bombs would soon explode and deteriorate once again the situation and provoke more and further conflicts that would spread out not only in Syria but would also spread out in the whole area.
هناك ضغط على السوريين لكي يقبلوا بمعادلة إما داعش أو الأسد.
Pressure are being or is being done on or made on Syrians so as to accept the following equation: whether to enforce them to choose between ISIS or Assad's regime.
لا أحد يمتلك بالمعنى الأخلاقي والحقوقي أن يفرض على السوريين مثل هذه الخيارات.
Well, no one has the right, not on the legal level, neither on the ethical level, to impose such options on Syrians.
هذا الخيار يشبه تماما أن تطلب من الإسرائيليين أن يقبلوا بهتلر رئيس مجلس وزراء لهم.
Well, such an option would be as follows. It's like if we were asking Israelis to accept Hitler as a prime minister.
لن أطيل أكثر أترك المجال لزملائي ولأسئلتكم شكرا جزيلا.
Well, I would like to prefer to stop by now so as to leave the floor for my colleagues and later on for any questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mazen. Ms. Hanad, would you like to make your statement?
Okay. Well, hello, everyone. Thanks for coming to see all this picture, to show it to the world. I was just a wife and a mother and a teacher in my country. I don't have the skill to give a speech or the art to give the speech, but only because I have message from my experience with the criminal regime, Al-Assad regime. When the revolution started, I became an activist. Like all the Syrians, just we ask for freedom and dignity. And this is our crime. So they arrested me. They humiliated me. They beat me. And then they put me underground for 7 months. I met there about 65 women in the same room, from 12 years old till 85 years old. 12 years old, why? Or 85 years old, why? Okay, I am an activist. I joined a group, secret group, to collect video for this demonstration of how the army, they beat the people and they shoot them and they kill them. But those what they did. Just to show you that sometime, many of the people now, even in the regime army, not because they want him or they are agree what he's doing, but just because they are scared. This little girl, because her uncle left the army, so to force him to come back, they take from the family member. Same thing with the 85 years old. Her son left the army, so they, to force him, they took her and put her in prison. She was sick. She must take twice a day insulin with high pressure also. This is the situation there. After 1 week, they arrested me on 15, like 2 days ago, on 15 of March, 2012. And this is my brother. On 22nd of March, 2012, also just 1 week between us, they arrested him. He is a military judge. He voted to be fair for justice. And he couldn't get the justice for himself. They put him in Sednaya prison for 2 years and 2 months. And then they killed him there. I continued to contact anyone came out from that prison to know what happened to my brother. And also maybe to know if he was angry from me, because maybe one of the reasons that he didn't flee from the country, that I was prisoner. All of them, they told me that he was very proud of me. And they kept beating him that day. Even it's not an investigation. It's after 2 years and 2 months, those sadists. They kept beating him with iron stick. They told me that they heard how his bones get broken. And he entered the room, vomiting blood, laying on the floor, cannot drink or can't eat, can't move till next day, and he died. When Caesar filed a picture, it's there, I was looking in every picture to see maybe my brother, one of the picture. Maybe it's not there, his picture, but he was one of them. He died under torture. And they throw him on the floor like those. And they wait till they are 60 bodies or 100 bodies to put them in one hole. I will not ask for something impossible. I'm not asking the world bring him back to life. But I want my brother right. Even if he died, I want to justify him. I want his body. I want a grave to my brother to put flowers on his grave as everybody do. Is it something impossible? All the world watching what's going on and what's happening to us. It's not fair. It's like deaf devil when you know how much the bad situation and you keep silence. We are asking to punish Bashar al-Assad. He is the killer. He give the green light to all the workers with this secret detainee places to do whatever they want. He is responsible and we want him to be punished. I will not sit and wait like my mom every day. She is talking to God and praying that to punish him. I will not wait for the heaven rule. I want him to punish here on planet Earth. Just guide me. Tell me where to go. Who is the strongest authority on planet Earth to complain about this person? This is a Bashar al-Assad person, not God, and he must be punished. Thank you.
Thank you, Hanadi. We give the floor to Ms. Hind Kabawat.
I'm sorry, Hanadi. I'm sorry that we're here and we have to watch these pictures and we have to discuss our family members about the Syrian people. And we can watch those pictures. Yes, thank you for having us all, and thank you for coming. But I'm sorry that we have to put Hanadi here to go through this pain. It happened to me. I was at the border in Rihaniye when this beautiful mother told me about her story. Her name is Im Walid. And she told me that her two kids went for this peaceful demonstration to what Mazen was saying. They were singing, they were dancing from Ghouta. They lived in Damascus. They had a dream, like everybody here, and especially in the international committee. We always learn about the big dream, the freedom. We heard about Martin Luther's speech about "I have a dream." And we thought the whole international community, they're going to support us when we're going to go and sing and dance for the freedom and for the dignity we dream about for years. I'm sorry that today Hanadi is crying because she lost members of her families in this. I'm sorry that Mazen lost also his lots of friends, and he spent years in prison. So Im Walid, the beautiful soul, she find out about the fate of her son from these pictures. I couldn't even look at it. I don't want even to see it. It hurt me as a mother. It hurt me as a mother. It hurt me as a woman to see a picture of a woman here. She was an activist. She was doing also only humanitarian work in Damascus. Beautiful soul. The European, they're asking us, the whole world saying, lots of Syrian refugees. Just check the pictures. Now you know why the Syrian people have to escape. People escape with their kids, with their children, because they don't want to see this fate again. I'm sorry, Hanadi. I'm sorry, Mazen. And I can assure you that we cannot forget this 10,000 of people detained by the Assad regime. But I can promise you, through this Geneva talks, we have constantly demanded the release of the detainees, especially the women and children. And they are, it's not precondition. It's our legal right for this. I'm proud that I have the women consulting group here. They're here with us, and they're also are working in this detainees files. We want them back. We want Hanadi to put flowers on the grave. We want to think about a good transitional justice, because we know in the end of the day, there will be no justice. There is no peace without justice. And we have to make sure that we can have our memories, but we cannot have it if we don't think and think about the freedoms, like the first day of the revolution. Thank you.
Thank you, Hind. Gareth Bayley, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Usahma, for this, and to the Syrian Organisation for Victims of War for bringing us together. I am profoundly humbled and privileged to be sitting here with Hanada, Mazen, Hind, Yahya, you, Usahma, on what is, again, a very sad day. The Caesar photographs are compelling evidence, brutally and forensically documented, of the regime, the Assad regime's calculated widespread attack on the Syrian people. It is a form of collective punishment. I would just like to note that I have the privilege of being here on the panel with you. I'm also accompanied today by colleagues from Sweden, Canada, Denmark, and the Netherlands who are here in solidarity with you. Solidarity, I'm sure, is not enough, but it's a start. We are absolutely clear and remain steadfast in saying that perpetrators of human rights violations and abuses in Syria are unacceptable, and the perpetrators must be held to account. The evidence is there on the walls for us all to see. Human Rights Watch has done extensive work, as have Amnesty International, and of course the UN's own Commission of Inquiry. There would be no sustainable peace in Syria without accountability, without justice, and as I heard yesterday, and that inspired me, without reconciliation. Justice focuses most specifically, of course, on Bashar al-Assad. My country and those here among us today, I believe, are clear and have been clear that there must be a transition away from Assad. This man has not only failed his country, he has attacked his country. And he stands as the prime recruiting sergeant of extremists in Syria, Daesh, Nusra, others. I support today the High Negotiations Commission's call, which is both profound and indeed noble, for the release of detainees. These people around us have died. Thousands remain in detention. The HNC has focused most clearly on releasing women and children detainees as a first humane step, an obvious step, you would think, a humanitarian obligation above all. I'd also recall that we are pressing for the Commission of Inquiry to have access to Syria. So far, they have been denied that access. The Commission of Inquiry has to be in a position to investigate what has happened and what is happening today. I think it's maybe worth a word, as one participant in the Geneva III negotiations, as they're called, is to look with a measure of hope to what we see ahead of us. On February the 4th, Hind and I packed our bags and left town, because Russia had for 2 days conducted 320 airstrikes by our estimate on Syria, and had bombed the talks to a stop. Today, we have a glimmer of hope, the slightest hope. Since that collapse into today, we see in the two task forces on the cessation facilities and on humanitarian access, slow progress, but progress nonetheless. The cessation is largely holding. Yesterday was one of the quietest days that Syria has seen since the beginning. Humanitarian access is a grinding, grinding task. It should be obvious that the besieged areas of Syria be relieved, the hard-to-reach areas be reached, and yet we slowly, very slowly, have to progress through this process. Particularly in connection to today, I welcome the announcement by the UN Special Envoy on Tuesday evening that detainees and their release and knowledge of their fate will be added to the work of the task forces. And that is something that has long been called for by the Syrian people and by their opposition, by those who stand for them. And that will now happen. Above all, I just want to pay tribute to you all. There are powerful Syrian voices here. And Hind represents the most powerful of all, the High Negotiations Commission, which is in Geneva to demand a just settlement to a conflict that has gone on for too long, over 5 years. It is Hind and her colleagues with her who are making the loudest and most eloquent case for those who have already died and for the many thousands who are still inside. They are the opposition. But I've always had a problem with the word opposition, because what they actually are the champions of the Syrian people. They are the conscience of the Syrian people. And here today, I wish them well in seeking the justice that has been so elusive to Syria for so long, and that I'm sure particularly Mazen and Hanada are waiting for. So I wish you fortune and good luck. Thank you.
Thank you, Gareth. We'd like to take some questions from the floor, but before we do, I actually have a question of my own. I'd like to ask Gareth, you said peace is not possible with accountability. No. Without accountability, of course. Can I ask you, why is the UN Commission of Inquiry not being permitted access to Syria? What are the mechanisms and decision-making process at play here? And what efforts are being made to establish a mechanism for accountability, even parallel to the political process? What are the difficulties there?
I won't go in at length at all. I think it is quite obvious that there are states not in this room today who do not share the objective that Syrians and we all share, and the envoys here share, for having accountability based on investigation and forensic work. So as in the Security Council, so with the Commission of Inquiry, we are compelled to work in an international system where at least one nation is not committed to justice. So that's the headline. We will continue the work to make sure that the Commission has access. We also support with other states, work to collect evidence and ensure that evidence is robustly and safely held for future accountability trials. But that is very slow work. I acknowledge that.
Very slow work. I have another question to ask on that note. Now, no one can claim to have a complete list of names of the detainees. What we do know is that there were tens of thousands tortured and killed in Syrian prisons, and that hundreds of thousands have gone through this pipeline. I would like to ask Mazen, who knows a bit about the issues of numbers and database, to explain a little bit what efforts are being made to consolidate those into one list. What do we know about the numbers, Mazen?
Um, حول الأرقام بالمطلق نحن من بداية 2011 عم نحكي عن مئات آلاف الأشخاص اللي خاضوا تجربة الاعتقال.
Regarding numbers, as of 2011, we can talk about hundreds of thousands of people who have been detained.
التقديرات للمؤسسات الحقوقية السورية بتحكي عن رقم بين 100,000 ل 300,000 معتقل احتمال يكونوا موجودين، قسم منهم قد يكون مفقود أو مختفي قسري.
According to estimates conducted by Syrian legal institutions, there could be between 100,000 to 300,000 of detainees. Some of them are still alive, some of them have just disappeared or forced to disappearance, etc.
المشكلة اليوم في سوريا أن حتى الجماعات والميليشيات المسلحة أصبح لديها سجونها ومعتقلاتها الخاصة.
The problem is in Syria nowadays, even paramilitary groups or military groups or armed groups, they do have their own detention centers.
الحكومة السورية طبعاً ترفض إعطاء أي أرقام أو أساساً أن تعترف بوجود قضية معتقلين وتعذيب وموت تحت التعذيب.
As for the Syrian government, they not only do not disclose any numbers, they do not even, I mean, the Syrian government does not even recognize the fact of having any detainees or practicing torture.
أعتقد أنه يجب على المبعوث الدولي وفريق الدولي الدول الداعمة أن تجبر الحكومة السورية على إعطاء قوائم رسمية بأسماء المعتقلين طالما أنها تدعي أنها دولة وحكومة ولديها أنظمة قضائية. هنا الفخ أن يطلب من السوريين ومن المنظمات الحقوقية السورية إعطاء قوائم أسماء. هذه مسؤولية من يقوم بالاعتقال أن يفصح عن الأسماء والأرقام التي لديه.
Well, actually, I guess that we should demand the UN Special Envoy, in addition to all international supporting bodies, supporting countries to Syria, to demand them, to ask them to force the Syrian government to disclose official lists of detainees, since they pretend to be a government, a state, and to have a judicial system and judicial courts. That would be a good thing to do so as to force them to disclose such lists and such information.
We will open the floor now for questions. Just raise your hand and pose a question, no problem.
If you're talking about accountability,
can you switch on your microphone?
Of course, yes. Jan Kuhlmann, German press agency, DPA. If you're talking about accountability, what exactly should it look like? Should it be a Syrian court? Should it be an international court? Or what's the idea you have?
Is the question to all of us?
Whoever wants to answer or wants to give an answer.
Gareth, would you like to take that question?
I'd like to take it, but I think I probably answered imperfectly. I'm sincere when I say this. It's not a diversion, but I think this is a question for Syrians to answer. It's a matter for the transitional negotiation that we're in now. My own background was in Iraq, where there was an Iraqi tribunal that came out of a political process. It was what it was. It was a bespoke solution for Iraq. I think Syria should decide what the solution should be for Syria. But that shouldn't be a decision, of course, by the current regime.
I think the Syrian must refer to the International Criminal Court. But while the Russians are blocking this, and they're doing it again, so the responsibility of our international friends to pressure the Russian to go ahead with this court. And we need to open also like the criminal cases, and it will be under the universal juridical court too.
العديد من البلدان اللي مروا بحالات مشابهة رواندا المغرب كمبوديا في نماذج عديدة طبعا الوضع السوري مختلف الوضع السوري بحاجة أن يكون هناك معايير محددة بتخص ما حصل في سوريا من الممكن أن تكون خليط بين هذه النماذج وبين محاكم وطنية ودولية
Of course, many countries have had similar cases, similar situations, such as Rwanda, Morocco, or even Cambodia. And they have, of course, specific patterns, specific models that they have adopted. However, the Syrian case is different. And I think that with regard to Syria, we need specific criteria, specific standards with regard to what happened. I think the best would be to have a mixture of the models or patterns that were adopted by other countries like Rwanda, etc., in addition to a kind of international tribunals or national tribunals as well.
عندما يوضع ملف المحاسبة والعدالة الانتقالية على الطاولة أنا واثق أن المجتمع السوري والمجتمع الدولي قادر على أن ينتج منظومة تتلائم وتتناسب مع الوضع لكن بداية علينا أن نضع قضية المحاسبة والعدالة الانتقالية على قائمة جدول أعمالنا
Once we have the topic of or topics of accountability and transitional justice set on the table, I'm sure that the Syrian society, in addition to the international community, both will be able to find and set the most suitable justice according to the situation. However, the first priority on our agenda should be accountability in addition to transitional justice.
We have time for a comment from the floor from Mr. Fadl Shokfe, please.
Introduce yourself.
Okay, thank you so much, Usama, and thanks for having us. I have a little presentation. I am Fadl Abdel Ghani Al Shukfa. I am the head of Syrian Network for Human Rights. We are documenting the violation in Syria since June 2011. We worked with the Commission of Inquiry since 2011. Before that, it was as an investigation committee, then transferred to be Commission of Inquiry. We work with OHCHR. They rely on us on all of their analysis, casualties in Syria. We worked also with our colleague in Amnesty International and Human Rights Watch. I'm so sorry about your brother and your family. I want to speak a little bit technically about Caesar photo. Caesar photo actually is a catastrophe of the Syria. Now the documenting casualties for the Syrian people who died under torture, which documented by us by name and photos and several details, 12,468 persons. Among of them, 165 children who is under 18 and 38 women who is above the 18. Actually, we issued a huge research about the Caesar photos on 15 of October 2015. We spent 5 months for this research. I discussed before with my colleague Nadim Houri from Human Rights Watch about we have to do something about those photos. We named the our report the photographed Holocaust. and human rights named If the Death Could Speak. Their research issued in December 2015 also, after 3 months from our research. So now we have photos. Our concern, who is the identity for those photos? We don't know. With Caesar files, which is the investigator by Carter, they ensured that those photos are real, that they have the metadata for each photos. But who is the identity? When the website start publishing the photos, we are disagree as a human rights defender to publish the photos like that. And I would like to thank you because you are hiding the face and you modify the photos, which is so good for us. So we take the chance after the photo published to, based on our data, which we recorded, we have those people arrested. We know them. We have photos for them alive, but we don't know now. We have now Caesar photo for the prisoners who died now. So we want to compare. So after this, the photos published, the family start to contact with us, and we start to communicate. It's so complicated actually to compare. And we, at the beginning, we are planning to do such kind of program in order to match the face when he is alive and when he is died, like CIA program. Mm-hmm. It's also complicated actually. So now we recognized from 3,000 photos based on our research, we are able to verify 772 cases who is, as Professor Yahya said, not only Syrian, including Palestine, Jordanian also, and including children from different sects in Syria. Now we have 772 cases, those from Caesar photo. What we did, we go back to our archive. We want to see those, how much we documented already in our archive. When we make match from these samples, we found that we only documented 123 cases only. So only 60%, and that's indicate how is the our documentation is always at the minimum level. What we are getting information in order, we have a huge network and a huge relation based on our 5 years cumulative work. Even that, we have only 60% from 3,000 photos only. That's how we are saying this. Since 2011, systematically widespread in the whole Syrian security forces branches. Regarding, this is very brief about the our studies. I have one comment about the Commission of Inquiry reports. Even if the Commission of Inquiry Usama entered Syria, they will. Get the same result. They will get the same result because they will never issue, as investigator and as their level, they will never issue any things without they reach to level. They ensured completely that this cases is happened. So the question is, what is the reaction? What is the action after the Commission of Inquiry announced this is crime against humanity? Where is the protection? If they entered Syria or if they is out of Syria, they will never issue any report or research until they get complete insurance that this case has happened based on meeting with the victims themselves, everything. Of course, it's better if they entered Syria, but now we have reports since December, the first report in December 2011. They said in several crimes, in torture, in forced disappearance, extrajudicial killing, sexual violence, the regime committed all of them systematically, which is crime against humanity. What is the action should be taken? Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Any other question from the floor? Hanna?
Hello. Thank you, everybody. I want to introduce myself in English first. I'm Hanan Al-Balkhi, and I am vice president for this association for the defense of the rights of the victims of the Syrian revolution. And I am representative for Syrian National Coalition in Norway. So we are in our organization seek to be the voice of the victims of the Syrian revolution who demand justice and equality and to be the voice in support in negotiations. So I introduce myself in this why? Because we are in Syria, political and victims. I want to continue my comment in Arabic. أنا تحدثت عن my الخلفية التي أنتمي إليها وهي وأمثلها وهي جهة سياسية وجهة وجهة من المدنيين والضحايا لأقول للعالم أن ما حاول النظام أن يصوره للعالم أن هذا الصراع هو صراع بين النظام والجهة أو المعارضة هو غير صحيح. المعارضة هي جزء من هذا الشعب الذي تعرض للقتل والتنكيل.
Well, I have talked about my background, my political background, my civilian background, because I'm one of those victims. I represent all those, and I belong to them. And I'm here to say to the whole world that the regime, the Syrian regime, tried to give the impression that this conflict between the itself, I mean the regime and the opposition, is fake. However, this is not true. This is not true, actually, and the opposition is real, actually.
لأن سأتحدث فقط عن التجربة الخاصة بي. أنا أخت شهيد وزوج أختي شهيد وزوج أختي الأخرى أيضا شهيد. إذن عندنا في عائلتنا ثلاث شهداء وأيضا كل واحدة من هذه الأخوة لها أطفال. هؤلاء الضحايا لا يمكن في هذه المفاوضات التي غيبت فيها مسألة المحاسبة والمساءلة أن لا يمكن أن ننسى ولا يمكن أن نسامح. ماذا سيحدث في هذه المسألة؟ كيف سنبني سوريا المستقبل؟ كيف سنصل إلى العدالة الانتقالية؟ كيف يمكن الوصول إلى الديمقراطية؟ ومن الغريب أن يتحدث المجتمع الدولي عن الديمقراطية الذي يؤمن بالديمقراطية والذي يطبق الديمقراطية في مجتمعاته أن يغيب مسألة المحاسبة والمساءلة مع هذا الكم من الجرائم والتي استخدمت فيها كل الأسلحة المحرمة دوليا من الكيماوي إلى التعذيب الممنهج إلى كل هذه الجرائم. كيف للمجتمع الدولي أن يغيب مسألة المساءلة والمحاسبة في المفاوضات؟
Careful, Gareth. This is a question for you, I believe.
Well, I wait for the translation to hear it twice.
I have talked about my personal experience. Actually, I'm the sister of a victim, of a martyr, and two brothers-in-law of mine have been also killed. So we have three martyrs in the family, and my sisters do have kids as well. So they are victims. That's why I wonder why victims were absent or absent in negotiations, why the matter of accountability has been also or is absent in negotiation. It's not mentioned in negotiations. Actually, we cannot forget, we cannot forgive about what future can we have? How can we be able to build our future, to talk about transitional justice, about democracy. It's quite weird. It's quite bizarre to see the international community talking and applying, even believing in, of course, believing in democracy, and despite this, just disregarding accountability in negotiations, despite all the crimes, the multiple and very numerous crimes that have been committed by the Syrian regime, and the use, illegal use of all kinds of weapons, of internationally prohibited methods and things like torture, like chemical weapons, etc. So despite all this, how I really wonder how this matter or issue of accountability is being disregarded in negotiations.
Thank you.
Sure, go ahead.
And apologies, I'll have to go to the task force on cessation straight away, but your challenge is extremely powerful. The answer is simple, maybe too simple. There is one country on the Security Council that blocks accountability for Assad. There is one country on the Security Council that protects Assad. There is one country in the Security Council that says it is not logical that Assad should leave power. That country has veto power. My country has chosen to respect international law. It has advanced systematically this case in the public domain and in the Security Council, that accountability must be central to a settlement in Syria. We have not been successful in that. We have been blocked in that. That does not change our steadfastness in defense of accountability. We see this as a matter, not only a moral matter, but a practical matter. If you cannot have accountability in the Syrian settlement, then you will never heal the wounds of Syria. There will be continued pain, recrimination, and a high risk of a resumption of the conflict. I agree with you that accountability must be central to the negotiations. Unfortunately, the international community of which you speak is blocked by at least one state that disagrees, and that state has power. And I'm not mentioning that state because I'm a polite diplomat, but we all know what that state is.
Thank you, Gareth. Would any of the other Syria envoys wish to comment on this? Sweden?
Our international prosecutors, or the International Chamber of our prosecutors' office, have established formal contact with the Commission of Inquiry here in Geneva and with a number of other organizations, international organizations, that are working hard to gather and systematize information about the crimes that have been ongoing in Syria. They are working on a number of individual cases, and as you know, Sweden is a country where many Syrians have taken refuge, but among those there could also be people who have committed crimes. A number of individual cases on the docket of our courts, I think so far two convictions, but also a general case under the universal jurisdiction that we have in Sweden is being compiled. It's again, as Gareth said, this is also a slow and arduous work, but that work is ongoing, and I think other countries are doing the same. This is not enough by far, but in the absence and waiting for international justice and justice in transitional justice in connection with the political talks, there are things going on, and there are small things we can do as a contribution to accountability. Thank you.
Can I just ask to clarify? You said that Sweden has established formal contact to systematize the cases. Are those in reference to the cases you have in Sweden?
Indeed.
And that is why national jurisdiction applies.
I think it's both to get help to gather information on this general dossier of Syria, but also in relation to individual cases on the docket of Swedish courts. Mm-hmm.
Would any of the other envoys wish to comment, perhaps? Monsieur Marc Gillet, very welcome to.
Very much, and thank you to the organizers for having invited us, the special envoys, to address this audience. I'd like to thank the Swiss Pen Club and also congratulate it for this engagement. This exhibition is very useful to many extent. It allows to keep the attention of the public opinion and of the international community on the crimes perpetrated by the regime, but also it pays homage to the victims of these atrocities. Since the beginning of the revolution, France has had strong links with the networks of the Syrian opposition that have acted sometimes in very difficult situations beside the Syrians, so that the crimes of Bashar wouldn't be unpunished. I think we should call that 5 years ago, the regime was made the choice to crush in the blood the pacific demonstrations of the Syrian people with a level of horror that is of no precedent in the 21st century. And the pictures of the Caesar's report that are unbearable and that are now fully authenticated by many reports, many experts, and this is very important for the cases before the judiciary, the whole testimony of the barbaric and cruel behavior of the regime. So, before these crimes, France that got the Caesar's report has deemed that it was of her duty to carry this to the judiciary. And this is why we have sized our national judiciary on this file. And of course, we hope that legally it will be possible to have criminal consequences on this. And we'd like to encourage other countries to do what? Besides, of course, we are continuing our fight against impunity, and this is why we have carried to the Security Council in May 2014 a project of resolution to put to the criminal international court the crimes committed in Syria. And as it has been recalled, that text has been supported by more than 100 NGOs, sponsored by 65 countries and voted by only, sadly, 13 members of the Security Council. And I shall be less diplomatic than my British colleagues. Sadly, Russia and China have opposed their veto to that decision, therefore refusing to give justice to the Syrian people, but also, once again, not very diplomatic, but insulted the memory of the victims. So our call is to all countries to try whatever legal procedures they have to size their national jurisdiction. I'd like to say that the work also goes on with the UN. We encourage the International Investigation Commission on the crimes on Syria to continue its investigations on the Caesar's files, and if possible to dedicate a specific report on that. And I have to say that once again, since we have now all technical relevant data on the file, on the pictures themselves, we know that they are authentic, that allows to carry full investigations. By the way, the Commission just has published a report on the detention centers in Syria, which the conclusions are terrible. They in particular conclude that the regime has committed extermination crimes that are constitutive of crimes against humanity in the frame of a state policy that is deliberate and systematic. And these elements are the signs that the that Assad cannot reconcile the Syrian people, and this is also the reason why he cannot constitute the future of Syria. And this is why, all together, in the framework of the ISSG, we work on a political solution. This is what I wanted to say, and thank you again for having organized this important meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Excellency. We have Professor Yahya Al-Aridhi, who wishes to comment on the issue of accountability.
I think we shouldn't be boring you with words, because Syria needs deeds, actually. We know that justice is very slow. Rafiq al-Hariri's identity is quite clear to the world, and his court has been on for 12 years. And we have 20 million Rafiq al-Hariris in Syria. Not like those, but those who are still alive are also victimized, if not physically, psychologically, really disturbed. We are coming. Another, in a matter of a month or two, another file like Caesar's is coming out. We are preparing in the National Syrian Assembly a file on the use of chemical weapons on Syria. So we'll have a chemical Caesar. The main thing, the accountability issue, transitional justice, shouldn't be sidelined when it comes to the political process or talking about the political settlement. And the other thing that Syrians want, I believe, whether they are still scared to death as loyals or people scattered all over the world, or those 55,000, those 11,000 pictures, they want one thing. No way for rehabilitation. No one can go that through that again. Not again. We have the right to say that particular term. Not again. That's enough for Syrians. So I don't know about accountability. I don't know about legal issues. There are people who are experts in these things, but they can do the job, but there has to be a will.
Ms. Hind Kabawat wishes to comment, and then we have a question from the floor.
I just want to leave you with a little bit of hope. First of all, with our women consulting group, we have two women detainees, Fatin Rajab and Dr. Abbasi, and they're still in prison, but we have the wife of Fadwa Mahmoud, the wife of Abdul Aziz Al-Khayr. She's in the hotel, and when I asked her to come and join us, she told me, I can't look at this picture, and we fully understand this. But I want you to know something very important in this panel, and just to give you a hope for the future, because it was a real revolution, not a holy war. We have a Druze with Dr. Aridi. We have a Sunni, Hanadi. We have an Alawite, and we have a Christians. And Usama too.
Yeah.
So I just want to tell you, if we want to think about transitional justice, and if we want to think about the future of Syria, this is, will be the future of Syria. And this is what's important. And I want a very dear friend who is also a member in the Women Consulting Group, Suad, who is a formal detainee, and she would like to say something hopefully and beautiful like her.
Thank you, Hind. السلام عليكم. أنا سعاد خبية، صحفية وباحثة وناشطة في مجال حقوق الإنسان. عملت على قضية المعتقلين منذ بداية الثورة، وكنت ممن بدأ بالتوثيق منذ الشهر الأول تقريبا للثورة، مع اعتقال عدد من زملائي المشاركين في الحراك السلمي آنذاك. الحقيقة مسألة المعتقلين هي ليست مسألة إنسانية بتصوري، بل هي مسألة أخلاقية تمس الضمير العالمي بشكل كبير جدا.
Can we wait for the translation, please? Go ahead.
Hello, my name is Saad Khabiye. I'm a journalist, a researcher, and a human rights activist. I have started working on the cause of detainees. I have started actually and been among the first ones who started documentation since the very beginning of the detention cases further to peaceful demonstrations. Regarding the detainees issue, actually it's not only about a human cause, it's an ethical one as well. It is addressed to the conscience of the whole world.
قبل أن أتحدث عن قضية المعتقلين، أريد أن أشير إلى أنني من عائلة دفعت 74 شخص، منها شهداء في هذه الثورة، يعني 74 شخص من عائلة خبية قتلهم بشار الأسد، منهم 5 فقط ممن كانوا يحملون السلاح، والباقي جميعهم عبارة عن نساء وأطفال. عمتي قتلت، هي وزوجها وأولادها وأحفادها وزوجات أبنائها، جميعهم قتلوا بقصف لطيران الميج على منزلهم، وهم من عائلة خبية عائلتي. ابن عمي قتل، هو وزوجته وبناته 5 وطفله الوحيد الذي انتظره 20 عاما حتى أتى هذا الطفل، كان عمره 5 سنوات، وقتلوا جميعا أيضا بقصف لطيران الميج، وباقي أفراد العائلة هم مدنيين أيضا. قضية المعتقلين، أريد أن أتحدث فقط عمن يحيطون بي من المعتقلين. فاتن رجب كانت صديقتي المقربة، عملت معها منذ بداية الثورة، كانت ناشطة سلمية مدنية تحرض على التظاهر وتشارك في المظاهرات. رزان زيتونة المعتقلة ضمن مناطق المعارضة، ضمن المناطق التي تسيطر عليها المعارضة أيضا. رزان زيتونة التي عملت معها لأكثر من 8 سنوات أيضا من أهم المعتقلين الذين يجب المطالبة بهم والسعي لإطلاق سراحهم. الكثير جدا من المعتقلين، عائلات كاملة معتقلة في سوريا، عائلات عفوا.
تفضلي. أوكي. بس نحن مشان الوقت بدنا نختصر التعليق.
Actually, with regard to the cause of the detainees, I would like to say that I would like to start by talking about my own family. 74 members of my own family have been victims, martyrs of the Syrian regime. They have been killed by Bashar al-Assad's regime. And only 5 out of these 74 victims or martyrs were carrying weapons, and the rest were women and kids. I would like to also to mention my aunt and her whole family, her kids, her husband, even her grandchildren have been all killed by, in airstrikes by MiG aircrafts. In addition to this, my cousin and his whole family, his 5 daughters, his son, who was age only 5, all of them were killed during the bombing by MiG aircrafts in airstrikes. So just to talk about close people to me who are being detained, I would like to mention a close friend, Fatin Rajab, with whom I have worked for a long time, since the very beginning. She's a peace activist. In addition to Fatin, I would like to mention Razan Zaitouni, with whom I have worked for 7 years, and she is being detained as well. And those two, in addition to many others, we are here to demand, I would like to demand their liberation. And of course, I would like to mention as well that entire family families, entire Syrian families are being detained or have been killed.
اليوم وليس غدا فقط اليوم وليس غدا على المجتمع الدولي على المجتمع الدولي أن يساعد في إطلاق المعتقلين شكرا لكم.
I think that today, not tomorrow, today the international community should help and do everything that could be done in order to free those detainees. Thank you.
Thank you for coming, everyone. Just as a final word, I'd like to say that these 11,000 people who are contained within the Caesar pictures, who were tortured to death, they were processed through two hospitals in Syria, in Damascus, in downtown Damascus, 601 and 603. They are only one part of what we see here, of a pattern of systematic state policy to exterminate. This is ongoing. And it's clear that the state does not treat its prisoner, its citizens as prisoners, but as hostages, selling part of their organs, even as a source of income. And to my knowledge, I've never come across a case like this. Not even the Nazis or the Khmer Rouge delighted in this type of documentation of their own crimes. But just to end it on a final note, I think it's better to, or on a positive note, it's better to light a candle than to curse the darkness. It's up to the Syrian people to make something, to seek accountability, but we cannot do this alone. We need the active help of our friends, especially the Europeans, to push this. And we need this as a part of a political process here in Geneva. We cannot do without it. And I don't think Europe can do without it either, since we are not the only ones paying the price for what is going on in Syria now. Thank you for coming, and have a very nice day.